The Convair F-106 Delta Dart is often called the ultimate interceptor. Created in the 1950s as a robust response to the growing threat of attack by Soviet bombers, it soon made its mark at the heart of the United States Air Force's interceptor fleet. Nicknamed the Six, its revolutionary design included a contoured Coke bottle shape, delta wings, and highly advanced avionics, making it a fearsome opponent for enemy aircraft day and night, whatever the weather. What's more, its potent Pratt and Whitney J75 engine boosted the F-106 to the supersonic realm, leading it to break the world speed record in 1959. In its later years, it still stood as a pinnacle of Cold War aerospace engineering, and even went on to join the ranks of NASA. Through the 1980s and 90s, it took part in a series of cutting-edge experiments, a fitting end for the remarkable career of the Six. The F-106 was developed as the final incarnation of the U.S. Air Force WS-201A project, which had begun in 1949 with the objective of creating a new supersonic interceptor aircraft by 1954. In 1951, the Air Force had initially selected an earlier Convair design, the F-102, but the prototype's performance turned out to be a disappointment. With the aircraft limited to subsonic speeds and relatively low altitudes. However, by 1953, Convair had identified an opportunity to improve its design using the brand new aerodynamic principle known as the area rule, formulated by NASA engineer Richard Whitcomb the previous year. According to this concept, the cross-sectional area of an aircraft should change smoothly along the length of the aircraft in order to minimize sudden changes in shape, which could cause increased drag and resistance at high velocity. Therefore, in order to conform to the rule, the F-102's fuselage was reshaped to have a Coke bottle or wasp waist contour, which would allow it to cut through the air more quickly and efficiently, while modifications were also made to the aircraft's engine, avionics, and weapons. Although the redesigned F-102 was now able to break the sound barrier, it could do so only marginally. What's more, not only did it become evident that the aircraft struggled to sustain such speeds, but there were concerns about its performance at high velocity, particularly its maneuverability and fuel consumption. Yet, with time of the essence, the Air Force gave the go-ahead for the aircraft's production despite its deficiencies, becoming the F-102A Delta Dagger, commonly known as the Deuce. Meanwhile, Convair continued its efforts to build a more adept interceptor, focusing on the creation of the F-102B, an extended production contract for 17 F-102Bs was given to Convair in April 1956. 2 months later, it was redesignated the F-106, giving it the distinction of being the second highest sequentially numbered P or F aircraft to enter service under the old numbering sequence used by the U.S. Air Force. With only the F-111 being higher. This sequence was later changed with the introduction of the 1962 United States Tri-Service Aircraft Designation System, which streamlined the naming conventions across the branches of the military. For this new aircraft, Convair abandoned the Pratt & Whitney J57 engine, used in the F-102A in favor of the more powerful J75, which provided an impressive 2,500 pounds of thrust with an afterburner. This allowed the F-106 to break the sound barrier far more comfortably than its predecessor, with a top speed of Mach 2.3, or approximately 1,525 miles per hour, or 1,325 knots at high altitudes, making it far more effective at intercepting enemy bombers. While accommodating this engine would necessitate a larger airframe, this would come with its benefits. Firstly, it enhanced the aircraft's structural integrity, which is crucial for withstanding the stresses associated with supersonic speeds and aggressive maneuvering during interceptions. Secondly, it provided a broader platform for the F-106's delta wings, so-called because of their triangular shape resembling the Greek letter delta. This increased the wing area, which in turn increased lift, particularly beneficial at the high altitudes where interceptors typically operate, as the air density is lower and generating sufficient lift becomes more challenging. It also meant larger control surfaces on its wings, with larger ailerons and elevons that provided more responsive and effective control during high-speed maneuvers, where precise and quick adjustments are needed to maintain or change the flight path. Moreover, Convair's design team took the new airframe as an opportunity to further refine the fuselage's shape, enhancing its aerodynamic efficiency. Building on the F-102A's application of the area rule, they made more precise adjustments to the fuselage contours, not just at the wings but along the entire length of the aircraft, aiming to further smooth out the changes in cross-sectional area and thereby reduce aerodynamic disturbances even more effectively, especially at transonic and supersonic speeds. The larger airframe also gave the F-106 space to incorporate more advanced avionics systems, representing a vast improvement over those used in the F-102A. As the aircraft's main role would be shooting down enemy bombers, it was given a state-of-the-art all-weather Hughes MA-1 fire control system that combined several functions such as automatic search, track, intercept, and missile guidance into one integrated package. This groundbreaking feature allowed the pilot to focus on flying the aircraft while the system handled target tracking and weapon deployment. The F-106 was also equipped with the AN/AESG-18 radar, which was more advanced than the MG-10 system used in the F-102A. This radar had longer detection ranges and better tracking capabilities, being the first U.S. radar system capable of lock-on and track-while-scan, allowing it to engage one target while continuing to search for others. Meanwhile, the aircraft's inertial navigation system, or INS, was capable of providing crucial accuracy for long-range interception missions. It helped maintain the correct course, altitude, and speed during engagements. The F-106 integrated digital computers to process radar data and flight parameters faster and more accurately, facilitating better decision-making during high-speed interceptions. As it had no guns or provision for carrying bombs, the primary weapons of the F-106 were its air-to-air missiles. The aircraft typically carried four Hughes AIM-4 Falcon missiles, which included infrared or heat-seeking missiles as well as radar-guided versions in order to be able to engage targets effectively day and night and under a variety of weather conditions. These missiles were compact and designed specifically for interceptor aircraft, providing the F-106 with versatile engagement options against enemy bombers and fighters. Unique among its contemporaries, the F-106 could also be armed with the AIR-2 Genie unguided nuclear rocket, an extraordinary armament intended to provide a last resort capability against formations of enemy bombers. The Genie was equipped with a 1.5-kiloton nuclear warhead, capable of destroying multiple aircraft within its blast radius, reflecting Cold War-era doctrines that anticipated large-scale bomber attacks. Another feature that significantly enhanced the F-106's operational effectiveness, particularly in its role as a continental defense interceptor, was its in-flight refueling capability. This enabled it to remain airborne for longer, allowing it to patrol sensitive airspace or remain on station while waiting for potential threats. During the Cold War, this was considered vital, as quick response times to intercept potential Soviet bombers were critical for national defense. It also meant that the aircraft was not limited by its initial fuel load, allowing it to cover much larger areas during its patrols, ensuring broader coverage and quicker response times across larger defensive zones. Indeed, during periods of crisis, in-flight refueling could keep F-106S in the air almost indefinitely, as long as other logistical and pilot fatigue factors were managed. This non-stop deployment capability was crucial for maintaining a constant defense posture. Furthermore, by maximizing the time spent airborne per sortie, in-flight refueling helped optimize the use of resources, including the wear and tear on aircraft and the logistical demands of multiple takeoffs and landings. When it came to safety, the F-106 boasted a unique provision. Instead of a standard ejection seat, it featured a full escape capsule system. When activated, the entire cockpit area around the pilot, including a portion of the canopy and instrument panel, would eject as a whole from the aircraft. This system was intended to protect the pilot from the extreme conditions associated with high altitude and high speed ejections, such as severe wind blast, extreme cold, and a lack of oxygen. The capsule was equipped with its own environmental controls to provide breathable air and maintain a survivable temperature until the pilot descended to a lower altitude or was rescued. While the base of the capsule included impact-absorbing materials and devices similar to airbags that would help cushion the landing and minimize the risk of injury to the pilot. On December 26, 1956, at Edwards Air Force Base in California, the initial prototype of the F-106 made its maiden flight, followed by a more fully equipped second prototype exactly 2 months later. However, testing during this period revealed disappointing results. The aircraft's acceleration and top speed did not meet Convair's expectations and showed minimal improvement over the F-102. Additionally, issues with the engine and avionics systems led to reliability concerns. These problems and the delays they caused almost led to the cancellation of the entire program. Nevertheless, despite the initial setbacks, the Air Force decided to continue with the F-106 program, largely due to strong support from the Air Defense Command. Based on the test results, officials were optimistic that modifications to the inlet duct cowling and charging ejectors would enhance both the acceleration and speed of the aircraft. These changes were planned after Category 2 testing and would be assessed during Category 3 testing. In an effort to speed up development and move towards production, the service took several decisive steps in April 1957, including the conditional acceptance of several F-106s from Convair that were still being used for flight testing. Additionally, the Air Force made quick decisions to resolve outstanding development issues. By mid-1957, funding was secured for 120 F-106As. Eventually, the USAF placed an order for 350 F-106s, significantly less than the initially planned fleet of 1,000 aircraft. The delivery of the single-seat F-106A and the twin-seat F-106B, which is a combat-capable trainer variant, started in October 1959 to 15 fighter interceptor squadrons. The F-106 entered service on June 2, 1959, joining the 498th Fighter Interceptor Squadron based at Geiger Field, Washington. Though officially named the Delta Dart, this was rarely used, with most referring to it by a different moniker, the Six. Soon enough, it had become the primary all-weather interceptor of the U.S. Air Force, eventually serving across the contiguous United States, Alaska, Iceland, Germany, and South Korea. The F-106's exceptional speed made it the clear choice for the USAF when selecting an aircraft for its attempt to set the world absolute speed record, a project known as Project Firewall. Sure enough, on December 15, 1959, it hit the headlines when Major Joseph W. Rogers achieved the record while flying an F-106 at 1,525.96 miles per hour at 40,500 feet. However, it wasn't all good news in the Six's early days. The aircraft soon encountered various technical hurdles, including issues with generators, fuel flow problems in cold weather conditions, and malfunctions in the combustor starters. In December 1959, a serious incident where the canopy of an aircraft was accidentally jettisoned mid-flight led to the temporary grounding of all F-106s. Thankfully, by the start of 1961, many of these issues had been addressed, thanks in part to two major modification and retrofit programs implemented during that period. And from then on, the aircraft's outstanding performance began to be recognized and appreciated by its pilots, boosting its popularity among them. Before long, it had staked its claim at the heart of the U.S. Air Force's interceptor fleet. Its cutting-edge technology and superior performance leading to the phase-out of older aircraft models that had previously filled the air defense role, such as the North American F-86 Sabre and the Northrop F-89 Scorpion, which were now rendered obsolete. While the Six was never used in overseas combat, it provided the United States with a robust defense against the threat of the Soviet Union and its allies at the height of the Cold War. With growing paranoia about the possibility of enemy bombers dropping a nuclear payload on the American mainland, the F-106 stood as a proud guardian, ever ready to see off the communist menace. As evidence of the aircraft's preparedness, one notable and intriguing incident occurred on February 2, 1970, when Captain Gary Foast, flying over Montana in an F-106 from the 71st Fighter Interceptor Squadron, found himself in a flat spin. Adhering to protocol, Captain Foust ejected from the aircraft. Astonishingly, his exit shifted the aircraft's balance enough that it stabilized itself, subsequently landing wheels up in a snow-laden field with only minor damage. This aircraft earned the nickname the Cornfield Bomber and was transported back to base via rail. After repairs, it returned to service and is now proudly displayed at the National Museum of the United States Air Force. By 1972, the F-106 was beginning to look a little dated, and a significant upgrade program known as Project Six Shooter was initiated. This aimed to enhance the aircraft's operational capabilities and extend its service life by addressing some of the limitations in its original design. One of the major modifications was the replacement of the original canopy, which had metal bracing, with a new, all-clear canopy that lacked these braces. This change significantly improved pilot visibility, which is crucial for situational awareness during flight operations, especially in complex air-to-air combat scenarios. Alongside the canopy upgrade, the project also included the installation of an optical gun sight and provisions for an M61 Vulcan 20mm rotary cannon. This cannon was integrated into the aircraft's center weapons bay, equipped with 650 rounds of ammunition. The addition of the Vulcan provided the F-106 with a conventional gun armament, offering more versatility in combat engagements, particularly in scenarios where missile armament might not be ideal. Even with these changes, inevitably, the F-106 was eventually superseded by newer aircraft. By 1981, the F-106 began to be phased out of frontline service with the introduction of the more advanced F-15A Eagle, which offered superior agility, avionics, and overall combat capabilities, marking the next generation of air superiority fighters. Some former Air Force F-106s were passed on to Air National Guard units across the country, who used them for various defensive and training roles, until they, too, retired the last of their sixes in 1988. Starting in 1986, 194 retired F-106s were withdrawn from storage at the Military Storage Disposition Center in Arizona and converted into unmanned target drones for the Pacer 6 program by the Aerial Target Squadron until the last was destroyed in 1998. Another user of the F-106 during its later years was NASA. While it acquired several F-106s for various research projects, perhaps none was more famous than the one nicknamed the Lightning Strike Plane. As part of a NASA investigation, it was incredibly struck by lightning 714 times without sustaining damage. In one particularly notable experiment in 1984, the aircraft was struck 72 times during a single hour-long flight at 38,000 feet. A key modification for these experiments was replacing the composite nose radome with a metallic one, which was essential for safety during the lightning tests. Although the F-106 could reach speeds of Mach 2.3, for these lightning experiments it flew at subsonic speeds of 300 knots, or around 350 miles per hour, at altitudes ranging from 5,000 to 40,000 feet. The aircraft was also equipped with optical sensors, including a video camera and a light detector, while data acquisition was carried out using digital waveform recorders that were considered state-of-the-art in the 1980s. In another innovative project called Eclipse, which ran from 1997 to 1998, NASA used six F-106 drones at the Dryden Flight Research Center. Project Eclipse aimed to demonstrate the feasibility of an aerotow launch vehicle. It involved towing a modified QF-106 aircraft in flight with a C-141A transport aircraft. This test successfully showed that it was possible to tow and launch a space launch vehicle from behind a tow plane, opening new possibilities for aeronautical and space research applications. Over the decades, the F-106 has dominated the skies and significantly shaped modern air defense capabilities, leaving an enduring legacy that continues to influence the strategic and technological frameworks of today's air forces.